Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you all. My name is Anuj Sonpal from Valorem Advisors. We represent the investor relations of Nirlon Limited. On behalf of the company, I would like to thank you all for participating in the company's earnings call for the second quarter of financial year 2020. Before we begin, I'd like to mention a short cautionary statement. Some of the statements made in today's earnings call may be forward-looking in nature. Such statements are subject to risks and uncertainties which could cause actual results to differ from those anticipated. Such statements are based on management's beliefs as well as assumptions made by and information currently available to management. Audiences are cautioned not to place any undue reliance on these forward-looking statements in making any investment decisions. The purpose of today's earnings call is purely to educate and bring awareness about the company's fundamental business and financial quarter under review. Now, let me introduce you to the management participating with us in today's earnings call and give it over to them for opening remarks. We have with us Mr. Rahul Sagar, Chief Executive Officer and Executive Director, Mr. Kunal Sagar, Promoter and Non-Executive Director, Mr. Manish Parikh, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Jasmine Bhavsar, Company Secretary, Vice President of Legal and Compliance Officer, and Mr. Ashish Baradia, Deputy General Manager of Business Development, Nirlon Management Services Private Limited. Now I request Mr. Kunal Sagar to give the opening remark. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Anuj. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our earnings conference call for the second quarter and the first half of the financial year 22. We wish everyone a very happy Diwali and hope everyone is safe and well. Let us start and take you through the financial performance of the company. For the second quarter of the financial year 22, the company reported a total income of approximately 80 crores, an increase of 5.3% from the previous quarter. EBITDA was about 60 crores, an increase of approximately 16.4% from the previous quarter. This represents an EBITDA margin of 75.28%. Profit after tax stood at about 34 crores, up by about 27.6% from the previous quarter. This represents a PAT margin of 42.2%. In the first half of the financial year 22, the company reported a total income of approximately rupees 156 crores with an EBITDA of about 112 crores, representing an EBITDA margin of 71.88%. Profit after tax stood at about 60 crores, representing a profit after tax margin of 38.63%. Now, when compared to the first half of the financial year 2021, the PAT was lower in the financial year 21-22 for two reasons. That is, total income was less due to higher vacancy in the first half of the financial year 21-22. And expenses were also higher in this quarter because provision for CSR expenses now need to be made in the first quarter of the financial year because of waterproofing expenses made in the first quarter before the onset of the monsoon and the higher amortization of marketing fees as per accounting norms. Coming to the operational highlights, the company continues to improve and perform steadily post the second wave of COVID-19. Operations are supported by the extraordinary efforts made by our employees, partners, vendors, etc., and the excellent support received from our licensees, lender, board, and major shareholder. With increasing numbers of the population continuing to be vaccinated, we remain optimistic that the effects of the pandemic will continue to recede during the second half of this financial year, despite temporary spikes which may be anticipated as people return to a more normal life and come back to work. COVID-19, we have taken and continue to keep in place stringent and ongoing measures to provide the required pandemic-related health and safety measures in NKP and Nirlon House. The company has completed its vaccination drive for all its eligible employees, vendors, contractors, and their dependents. Or all our eligible personnel have taken both doses of the vaccine. Licensing. As on 30th September 2021, approximately 148,000 square feet of area was vacant, as against 158,000 on June 30th, 2021. Of this 148,000 square feet vacant area, Morgan Stanley has licensed and occupied approximately 38,000 square feet in October 2021. The company is in advanced discussions to license an additional approximately 51,000 square feet in quarter 3 financial year 22. On this basis, and factoring in another approximately 5,000 square feet being vacated in November 2021, we estimate vacancy to be down to approximately 64,000 square feet at the end of quarter 3 financial year 22. In other words, we estimate occupancy to be in excess of approximately 95% as on the 30th of December 2021. IBM has recently given notice to vacate approximately 37,000 square feet in April of 2022, the license for which, in any case, was scheduled to expire in July 2022. Preliminary discussions have commenced to relicense this space. Phase 5 handover. With the completion of Phase 5 estimated in Q3 financial year 22, we are looking forward to an improved performance by the company estimated to begin in Q4 of financial year 22 and Q1 of financial year 23. The entire Phase 5 chargeable area of approximately 1.16 million square feet has been committed by JP Morgan. We are glad to say that based on our most recent constructive and positive discussions earlier this week, the handover to JP Morgan is estimated in December 2021, and license fees are estimated to begin 5 months thereafter as per the contracted license fee-free period. It is worth mentioning that the handover process to JP Morgan is already underway and is proceeding based on agreed norms. Dividend. As discussed in our earlier call, the company will recommend dividends, whether interim or final, to the maximum extent deemed prudent after ensuring it has adequate cash reserves to meet any potential contingencies. Thank you. With this, we conclude our opening remarks and open the floor for questions.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. The first question is from the line of Laksh Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Oh, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. Very good afternoon. My first question, IBM will vacate 37,000 square feet in April 2022. Is that included in the 325,000 square feet, which is to renew on FY23? My next question, or should I wait for the answer and then go for the next question?
It is included. Yes, it is included in the
Q2. Yes, it is.
Okay.
So, let's try and answer your question, shall we?
Yes, I have question.
You're a little bit audible, but it can be a little bit better.
The audio is not entirely clear, but from what we understand, you're asking about IBM is vacating, whether it's part of the 325,000 square feet that was due for renewal in the financial year 22-23. The answer is yes, that's correct.
Okay. And if clients expire before the renewal, then will we give them the existing rates only, or will we be charging a higher to them? Because the 1,45,000 square feet is vacating before expiry.
Sorry, we didn't really understand the question. Apologies.
Sorry, can you just speak a little bit slower because it's not so audible?
Yeah, am I better now?
Better.
So I was asking that 1,48,000 square feet are vacating before the expiry. So will we be charging them on the existing rate, or will be a bit higher?
Which is this 1,48,000? Are you referring to the existing vacancy?
Yes.
Okay.
So we are we estimate that the approximate rates that we will be getting for this vacancy when we are able to license this space will be approximately the rate that is currently what we are licensing at.
Okay. My next question. In the annual report, we have mentioned that repayment period is for 7 years, starting from June 2022. And in the the investor presentation, it is saying that the repayment period is like for 9 to 10 years. So have we got an extension for the repayment period?
That's a good question. The final repayment period is something that we'll be discussing and finalizing with the lender going forward. The current lender, HTSC, has already given us a moratorium of roughly 5 years during our construction period. And we estimate that it will be 7 years during which the amortization will take place going forward. We will be discussing with them to understand whether there is a possibility of a longer amortization or not.
Okay. So given the longer amortization, will we be going till the end, or there will be a bulk payment in between?
Sorry? What was the last part of the question?
Will we be paying in between itself, like if we try to cover the debt earlier before the expiry of the repayment period itself?
You're asking if you will prepay the debt, am I right?
Yes.
That's not a decision that we've taken at this point. We want to understand what the final amortization period will be, what the final terms will be, and what our final cash flows will look like. And then at that point, we'll have the decision whether to prepay, whether to ask for further moratoriums, whether to use the cash to accelerate payment to the bank, whether to return more money as dividend. Those are issues that will be addressed and finalized as we go forward once the capitalization of phase 5 is complete and as we receive the cash flows from phase 5.
Understood, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Samarth Singh from TPF Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my questions. I missed your opening remarks, so I apologize if some of these have already been addressed. My first question was on just our debt structure. Any thoughts on trying to get at least a part of the debt fixed, given the favorable interest rates that we currently have?
That's very much a part of the discussions we are having, and whether or not we decide on a fixed rate will of course depend on what is the kind of premium that the fixed rate will attract as compared to a variable rate. But it's of course very much part of any discussion we'll be having as regards the structure of the debt going forward post capitalization of phase 5.
Yeah, but it is something that we are aware of based on the current situation with interest rates right now. So it is something that is factoring in our talks once we transition from construction to LRB, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a fair question, and it is definitely something which we are taking very seriously.
Okay, excellent. And I'm sure you already addressed this in your remarks, but any further update on the REIT structure?
Actually, we didn't address that in our remarks. The REIT structure is a similar answer to what we had the last time, in that we continue to look at the legal and the regulatory possibilities of doing that in our context of being a limited company. And we have increasing and very useful information in that regard. Whether or not that is a decision that we would finally take, and whether or not that's something that would happen, is not something that we currently have in any way decided. It's purely in the stage of where we are collecting and collating data to see what would be the most beneficial outcome from a shareholder and a company point of view.
Okay, thanks. And what was, what will be the final cost of construction for phase five?
What will be the final cost of construction? You mean in absolute numbers or in square foot, or what do you mean?
Absolute numbers. Absolute numbers. What square feet? Either one. Cost per square foot or absolute. Either one.
Yeah. Okay. So just approximately in terms of the hard cost. Okay. That is the construction cost. It will be approximately on chargeable area somewhere in the region of maybe 6,000 rupees a square foot on the chargeable area. That's the hard cost, that's the actual construction cost without any other cost of interest and cost of premiums and statutory cost, etc., etc. Without the soft cost as well. So this is purely the construction cost.
Right. Okay. And I'm wondering if you guys have done...
That's on chargeable area at 80% efficiency, yeah? Because if your chargeable area, if you change the efficiency, then of course it can go up and down. So that's at 80%. It's about maybe a little bit over 6,000.
Okay. That's very helpful. And I'm wondering if you guys have done this sort of study on, if you were to build the same square feet today with the rise, the increase in cement and steel prices, what that amount would work out to?
We haven't done that
analysis.
We can just say that it would definitely probably be a little bit higher than what it was. But having said that, also there have been so many different types of fluctuations even during our construction during our peak construction in 2017, 18, 19, whenever it was. So it's not the easiest question to answer specifically. Of course, some things are always going up and some things may come down, and we did have increases in 2017, 18, in 2017, 2018, 2019 as well. To some extent, this last increase that has happened in the last 12 to 18 months, the majority of our construction was completed. But having said that, we did have significant increases in steel, especially during our construction period as well. So yeah, it's a fair question, but it's a little bit hard for us to give a specific answer in terms of percentages.
Okay, and just sort of taking that thought a little bit further, the reason I asked the question was, you assume that if your construction costs go up, then over a slightly mid to long term, the rental yields should also go up to match that increased cost of construction. So do you think that, I understand that the demand scenario might not be, very strong right now, but do you think that because of this increased cost of construction, future construction would obviously be at a higher cost per square foot and therefore would require a higher rent per square foot?
So, Samad, I think as far as our thought process on the rental goes, the idea is always that we want to make sure that we rent at a level where the licensee is has an incentive to stay here for the full period of 9 years or 10 years or the longest possible lease, and so we have the most stable possible cash flows. That's always been our thought process, and that's what it will continue to be. Of course, we factor in our standard escalation of 15% every 3 years, as I'm sure you're aware. And on that basis, we want to ensure that whatever levels of rent that we continue to rent at, we are able to go on the basis that an escalation over two or three escalations over a period of 9 or 10 years, which is the length of the license, will be affordable and workable from the licensee's point of view as well as from our point of view.
Right.
So that's what the guiding thought process will be.
Okay, got it. Then, thanks a lot.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Deepak Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just a minute. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. Today in the opening remarks, you have mentioned about this distribution of dividend. And even in a previous call, sir, am I audible?
Yeah. Not bad.
As per a previous call also, we were deliberating to distribute rupees 150 crores to be received from JP Morgan and other cash balances as dividend. Sir, I just want to know how much is the cash balance as of 30th of September, that is, which can be distributed as dividend, sir?
Mr. Jain, I think, you know, the first thing we want to clarify is that this 150 crore of deposit that is coming from JP Morgan is not earmarked for payment of dividend. That question had come last time and we had clarified that the last time as well.
Okay.
This is a deposit that is part of the JP Morgan contract and that will be used to pay all expenses, you know, the phase 5 related expenses as well as other expenses as well as dividend. It's not something that is specifically earmarked only for dividend or only for any particular expense. It's just the amount of deposit.
Okay.
Just to be clear on that.
Okay.
I'll just tell you the cash balance in a second as of 31st March 2022.
88 crores.
The cash balance on 30th September was 88 crores and out of that 72 crores was paid out in the first week of October for the payment of the 8 rupee dividend.
Okay.
Right, and at the end of October, it was approximately 20 or 22 crores.
Okay, so we are planning to distribute this 20 crores as interim dividend.
We are not, there is no specific plan and we haven't said specifically that we are going to distribute this 22 as dividend. What we have consistently said in the last two meetings is that we are not intending to hold on to surplus cash and that we intend to distribute that level of dividend, whether interim or final, that we deem is prudent based on the cash flows that we have and after taking into account any contingencies that we think will be forthcoming at that point in time. But the once again, the thought process that we have outlined in the last two calls as well as what we'll do again this time is that the idea is not to hold on to cash but to distribute as much as we believe is the prudent amount to distribute.
Okay. It's very helpful, sir. Sir, my second question is, when we are going to charge depreciation and interest cost of phase 5 to P&L account, that is at the time of handover in December or when we receive rent in May 2022?
Yes,
so essentially, you know, we of course have to discuss with the auditors of the company and take their view as well as to how these things are done and when they are done. And essentially, once we have a clear date for the handover to JPMC, it will usually, this capitalization will happen in and around the date as for normal cost as happens in all companies and in all businesses of this nature.
So at this point, as we mentioned in our opening remarks, we estimate that the handover will happen in December. We estimate roughly about middle of December. In our preliminary discussions with the auditors, they have indicated that the capitalization for phase 5 will therefore happen simultaneously, subject to confirmation, as Rahul said.
Yeah.
And from that point onwards, depreciation and interest would come on to the P&L of the company. At the same time, this is the first phase in which we are under the Ind AS accounting system, as against the earlier IGAAP. And so the straightlining of the license fees will also occur from the same date. So there will be an inflow in the P&L as well as an expense on the P&L beginning from the date we capitalize, estimated roughly right now in December or equal to the handover date.
Yes.
No, but you have told that we'll be receiving rent only after 5 months of handover.
So again, Mr. Jain, just to clarify that, the cash flow from the rent will begin 5 months from handover, which is, let's say, approximately in May of 2022.
Yeah.
The P&L effect of the cash flow, or the P&L effect of the license fees will be taken from the date of capitalization, which will be approximately in December 2021.
Okay.
So there's two different parts. One is the P&L effect, the other is the cash flow effect. Is that clear?
Yeah, it's very clear, sir. Thank you so much, sir. And my last question is, sir, regarding this is a media report, that is there is a data center boom in India. And GIC, for some reason, has paused making more data centers in Singapore. So do we stand a chance to enter this business and see that We are a multi-location company. Any thoughts on this?
Mr. Jain, we have no information on this particular media report, so we won't comment on that if you don't mind.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. It was very helpful, sir. Thank you.
Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants, please limit your question to 2 per participants. You may rejoin the question queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Ashok Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Am I audible? Thanks a lot. All our questions have been answered. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Jain.
Yeah, thanks.
The next question is from the line of Harshit Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, Mr. Jain.
Yeah, my question has been answered, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Reminder to the participants, if you have a question, please press star then 1 on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Laksh Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead. Mr. Laksh Jain, you may please go ahead with your question.
My questions have been answered already. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bhupendra Tiwari from ICICI Direct. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So my question is that we've been asking about what is the future of the business in terms of, you know, further expansion. Of course, we do not have a space there at NKP. And have we kind of thought of reinvestments of the cash flows that would be accruing over the next 5, 10, whatever years that we are coming? Or is it a steady state only existing rental kind of a business that we see as of now, right now, as we speak?
Mr. Tiwari, at this point, we are evaluating the possibility of any further expansions amongst the other options that we have. What we are clear on at this stage is that we will continue to distribute our excess cash. And when we have any potential investment opportunity, we feel we would be able to take advantage of that given our capital structure at the moment. Does that answer your question?
Perfectly fine, sir. Now, the second part is that have we had any discussion with the co-promoters, that is GIC, in terms of their involvement, in terms of further involvement or further partnership or further kind of expansion part of it? Of course, you said that you are evaluating in terms of the growth part, but because they already have that huge portfolio in India in terms of the other assets, do we fall into the purview of that kind of investments, that portfolio, or it's a separate investment, standalone investment for GIC, which stays as it is?
All our discussions as far as Midland goes happen, of course, with and in very close consultation with GIC. So all the answers that we are giving you are something that we have discussed with them numerous times, and also that we discuss with them regularly and constantly.
But we don't. We our discussions are restricted to the NL, to the non-related issues, and we are not able to comment on any discussions with GIC which are non-related.
We don't discuss the broader portfolio with them. We discuss in the Nilon context.
Yeah. Fair enough, sir. I think that was useful. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star then 1. The next question is from the line of Dilip Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Sir, recently, there have been media reports about interest rates falling sub 4% for A-plus clients. Do we stand a chance to reduce our borrowing cost further down from the 7.25% that we have presently, and how soon will we be able to reduce this?
Okay, so the company is evaluating in detail extensively the existing debt and the debt structure, etc., including the interest rate. and we are of course doing the best we can to be as efficient as possible with regard to our debt, and which includes interest rate as well, which includes the debt structure and the interest rate as well. And we are going to continue to evaluate extensively the best possible options for the company as we transition from construction into LRD.
To specifically answer your question, we do expect that there will be a further reduction that we can make in the interest rate that we currently have, which is 7.25. We have not heard any indication that it will be anywhere close to the 4% that you mentioned, but we do believe that there will be some level of reduction from the current levels possible.
How soon can we expect that, sir?
It's an ongoing discussion. It won't be too far in the distance. It won't be too far away, but we won't like to put a time frame on it specifically. But it's not something that is a short-term discussion. It's not a long-term discussion that we're having to do it as quickly as is possible to do it.
Okay, so you're currently deliberating on it. So we can expect something positive. We don't know the time.
Yes, but we are not speculating on how much that will be and exactly when it will be, but we do believe that there will be a reduction.
Yeah,
we can get some reduction.
We can't give you
fair enough.
Your number and your date,
I have another question. Post the COVID second wave, there are many media reports about huge growth in office leasing inquiry, for example, by DLF, Embassy, etc. Do we stand a chance to fill our vacancies soon in the Q3 itself? Is that possible?
So as we mentioned in our remarks, and as we will clarify now, we specifically expect that the vacancy will drop from the level of 148,000 square feet to about 64,000 square feet. We estimate that by the end of December, based on concrete discussions that we are having.
Yeah.
Okay. Apart from that, there are certainly discussions which we hope will fructify in the fourth quarter of this financial year. But since those are not at a stage which are final, we are not giving you any kind of guidance on that part of it, because those are still discussions that are in relatively earlier stage.
Okay, but are you seeing an increase in the number of inquiries made very, very recently?
There hasn't been any particular jump that we see. There's not been any particular fall off in inquiries. They've been quite steady.
Okay. And sir, my last question is, we were in deliberation with our major shareholder GIC to find a more tax efficient way of distributing profits, for example, the REIT structure. What is the progress on this discussion as of now, sir?
That remains a discussion between GIC and us. That is a very high priority for us. And as we mentioned a little earlier in the call as well, that being a listed entity, there are a lot of issues that we need to factor in from a regulatory point of view and from a taxation point of view, that we continue to receive very useful and good information on, and that we continue to discuss with GIC. GIC has a lot of good information that they continue to discuss with us. We have no conclusion on that at this point, but we are working towards seeing what might be the best possible potential outcome as far as that aspect is concerned. There is no definitive conclusion on that as to whether it can be A, B, or C. But the idea is to try and see what best is possible to do, of course.
Okay. Very helpful, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you. And best wishes with you.
Thank you.
Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants. If you wish to ask a question, please press star then one. The next question is from the line of Mukesh Kothari, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. In terms of REIT, I just want to understand, I believe there's a restriction in terms of multiple portfolio a REIT should have. So is it possible that the GIC might look at their other properties and the property of NKC as well, and then come up with three?
It's It's a question at the GIC level, which we would not really
comment on
because it's something that is to do with their overall strategy in terms of what they will do in India, and we'd like to confine our answers to what is related to Nirlon here.
Understood. So if there is an option given to you, would you take that option, I mean, in terms of unlocking through this route?
I'm sorry, that's not a yes or no answer. We won't want to answer that at all.
Understood. Okay. Second question is basically on the interest cost. So next year, we can safely assume that on a 1,000 crore debt that you have, which won't be capitalized going forward, the interest, there will be additional hit of around 70 crores to the P&L in terms of interest.
Sorry, could you clarify the question for us? Are you asking what the EMI might be?
No, the hit to the P&L in terms of interest cost, additional 70 crores, right? Basically, 1,000 crores is the debt.
Yeah, got it. So assuming your debt is right now 1030, it will be at approximately 7%, it will be approximately 70 crores, as you said. So that will work out to approximately six crores a month.
Understood.
It just depends what the final number is on the debt.
Sir, in your presentation, you have said that around 200 crores would add to your top line without much addition to your operating expenses. So can we assume that? I mean, we will maintain the same kind of EBITDA around 75% going forward for the new property as well, for the phase 5 property as well.
Well, in general, we believe that with the increase in top line, we are not going to have a proportionate increase in the expenses. So we certainly expect and believe that EBITDA will be increasing beyond what it currently is. Because the only variable costs like property management fees, CAM expenses, will increase in line with revenue. Other costs, the administration and other costs will not increase in the same proportion, and therefore margins will certainly improve on an EBITDA basis post phase 5. That is the whole one of the biggest advantages that we are going to get from phase 5. And that's exactly what we are trying to say in that particular portion of the report.
Okay, fine. Understood. One final thing. So basically, you will get additional cash flow of around, say, 200 crores pre-tax, and your loan is around 1,000 crores. So we can easily, I mean, if say nothing happens, we can easily look at say 5-year period to close out the loan, right? I know it could be much earlier.
No, so again, you are, I think, making an assumption that we would use all the money or a substantial part of the excess cash flow to pay down debt. So that is not any decision. That's not a decision that we have taken. You know, whether we choose to pay down debt immediately, whether we choose to extend the amortization period beyond what it might otherwise contractually be or what it might normally be, that is a decision that we are going to be taking going forward. But it is certainly not something that we definitely decided that because we have the excess cash, we are definitely only going to pay down the debt. Our options are very clear before us. It's obviously debt is one of them, but the payment of dividend, the distribution of dividend, as well as other potential areas that we might want to look at are certainly areas that we are keeping open, and we would decide based on what we feel is the most relevant for us at that point in time.
Understood. One final question on LRD. So I assume LRD is, I believe LRD is cheaper than 7.25 term debt that you are looking at. So is there any discussion and what sort of arbitrage is there in terms of the interest differential?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we just answered that question a few minutes ago. So basically, what we're saying is now we are looking in a lot of detail extensively at the best possible options for us to make our debt structure efficient in terms of structure and in terms of interest rate as well. And once we get the handover going and make the final transition from construction into LRD, we do expect, of course, that things will be a lot will be less than this number of 7.25 as we indicated earlier. So yeah, we are working very extensively to make sure that our debt structure is as efficient as possible in terms of the final, in terms of the interest rate, in terms of the actual interest rate as well as the structure.
Fine. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank
all
you.
The best.
Thank you. Reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. I'd like to remind all participants present in this conference, if you wish to ask a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Kunal Sagar from Nirlon Limited for closing comments.
Thank you very much for the questions and for your participation. We appreciate it very much. Anuj, is there any other point that we need to be discussing?
No, I think we're good. We can close.
So thank you very much to everyone for making the time, and it's much appreciated.
All the best.
Thank you. On behalf of Nirlon Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.